Now, are the four states or three states equal in all people? They cannot be. They cannot be equal in all people. And Turiya state, as you have asked, is only experienced by the evolved. Everybody does not experience the Turiya state. Although, when you reach Turiya, you are aware that everybody is actually in Turiya, but they are not aware of it. But normally they are not, one does not experience Turiya, because Turiya involves what? It involves that you have freed yourself from your little ID, that you have washed yourself clean, that you are not bothered about anything. Neither the past nor the present is touching you. You are quiet and absolutely equanimous. Thoughts may come, you are not caught in the thoughts. That is Turiya. Now, you can't say everybody is in that state. When you touch that, you understand that in real, pure, conscious, core of your consciousness, everybody is in Turiya. You have not realized it. You will realize it only when it is transformed to your waking state of mind. Which is why I said that it is through waking state only that Turiya can be reached, not through deep sleep. When the waking mind becomes aware of this, then the waking mind completely ceases to be. Then there is only Turiya. But it has to be there to understand. You can't sleep and go into Turiya. And you cannot drug the mind and go into Turiya. So if somebody says, I'm taking some chemicals and I'm going into Turiya, it cannot be Turiya. Because the mind has to be fully alert before Turiya can be touched in waking state. Now, you may be having some visions, but that doesn't mean anything. In Turiya, all vision cease. There is only one reality. There is one ground.
You said when you are just coming out of deep sleep, that moment, is that?
Yeah, that is kind of a precursor to Turiya. That's kind of make you realize that there is something on, going on. When you come out of sleep, you don't want to wake up. If you can also prevent yourself at that time without going back to sleep and not waking up, then perhaps you can touch something which is close to this. But it has to be in waking state. When you come back, all the memories will be there. But then you will not be affected by them. In Turiya, there is only one reality. There is nothing left. Memories meaning there are two, three people. Then there is only, without two, there is no memory, right? There is only one. What memory do we carry? Nothing.
So you will not even remember you reached Turiya. Just
dissolve. No. When you reach Turiya, you have reached the core of your consciousness, so you will be fully conscious, but not as you. Not as you, separately. This is very technical, I think you better go into Turiya and figure out. Can't go more than this, I can't explain this. All the Upanishads speak of the unblemished reality that transcends time and space. Why did the differentiation into Jivatma struggling to unite? It never came about. When you wake up from this and look and wake up from this dream, nothing came out from nowhere and nothing happened. It's now that you, how did it happen? Where did it come from? That there is nothing has come from anywhere. It is always the same. Let's put it this way. It's not an actual example. I'm very happy. Had a good meal. Have a good wife. So I feel I must enjoy myself. In that joy, after some time, a baby is born. How is the baby born? Because of my joy. right? Both have joy. So the baby is born out of joy. And then this baby also must have the joy in itself, which I have. Then it grows up and slowly, slowly gets lost in this world, not knowing of that joy from where it came. Then one day when it realizes it, it figures out that there is no birth and there is no death. So in the interim period, we have this question, why did it happen? When you touch there, there is no why there. Because nothing happened. Somebody wrote a biography called Nothing Ever Happened. So in our present state, we have these questions, why? When you touch that, that question is not there because nothing happens. There's only that. And you can reach there. Anybody can touch that. Nobody is prohibited from touching that. It's completely given to your free will to figure out if you want to do it. That's one thing which anybody can reach. You may not be able to become rich, somebody may not be able to become a good singer, somebody may not be able to become a mother, all these are there. But there is nobody who is banned from reaching the ultimate truth. Everybody has equal access. Only one has to wake up to it. There are no special individuals. Yeah. Maybe you try this many birds, that's a different matter, if you believe in birds. Where are they blowing your cones? Or is it Anahat Shabd? We are all here. Okay, what is the significance of this particular sound of Om? Why not any other sound? I explained that already. This sound is a special sound. Somebody went to a great saint and said, my son has become a black sheep. So, he said, what do you expect? When we used to go to school, in the nursery, they used to say Ram Ram, Hari Om, you know. First thing he heard was, ba ba, black sheep. So, he become a black, what can I do about it? So this sounds, special sounds like Om and all that, if they can be inculcated in childhood, it will be a great thing, because then somewhere along the line it will catch up. But in today's situation, don't do it. You will think you belong to some party. So here we are. Any other questions? Yeah.
Sometimes we talk about the gap between 2 ohms.
2 ohms. It's not only 2 ohms actually, it is the gap between 2 thoughts. See, when you say Om, thought is also involved in chanting, right? You say Om. Now the next Om hasn't come yet, there is a gap, right? In that gap there is the Ardha Matra, which is silence. It's like after the bell has rung, there is... That is what is meant by the gap between 2 ohms. And while you chant Om, while it's important to chant Om, if you are doing something important, then it is also as important to listen to the gap between the 2 ohms. Because that's where it originates. Before you say, start for Om, there is nothing, no? Then you say Om. Again, there is nothing. So, all somethings come from nothing. So, which is why some people call it Shunya. Shunya does not mean nothing. Shunya means no thing. It's not a thing, so you cannot define it, so you call it Shunya. Only Shankara was a little upset. He said, better to call it Purna instead of... Shunya, and that he was so close to Buddhist philosophy is evident from the fact that when he went to Varanasi and preached the Upanishads, and told them all your rituals are not going to help. Karmakanda is not going to help. You have to have Viveka and Vairagya and find out the truth. They said this fellow must be a Buddhist in disguise. So actually the pandits called him Prachanna Bhautika, one who was a Buddhist in disguise. Because the why? Because the teachings of Buddha are based on the Upanishad. Except that where usually Purna is used, he uses the word Shunya, which has a purpose. The Mahamudra doctrine says, from that nothing comes everything. Now don't think that it is not there in the Upanishad either. In the Chandogya Upanishad, a son of a rishi is talking about, he is sent somewhere else to learn the truth. So he comes back and his father asks him, have you found the truth? He says, I think I have. Then he says, if you think you have, you haven't. Either you have it or you don't have it. So there is a banyan tree there and some seeds are fallen down. He says, go and pick up the seed. So he brings it. He says, what do you see? I see a banyan seed. Okay. He says, peel it. So he peels. What do you see? I see the kernel inside. Peel it. What do you see? I see some tiny black seeds. Just take one of those seeds and peel it. He peels it. What do you see? He says, I see nothing. And the rishi says, it is out of that nothing that this huge banyan tree has come. See, so this is the meaning of shunya. Not that it is nothing. It is that which we cannot describe, we cannot define. Nothing exists. And now you apply it to your mind. When everything is quiet, there is no thought of you, what is there? That from which everything came. Which is what? Brahman or Shunya, whatever you want to call it. Purna. And the Upanishad says, in that completeness, it is never less. It is always the same. You can take anything out of it, but it will remain the same. Actually, you cannot. Purnamada, Purnamidam. Here, Purnamidam refers to your own Atma. I am Atma Brahma, Purna Mada, Purna Midam, Purna At Purna. From that Purna came this Purna. Purnasya Purna Matahai. From this, when it is removed from that Purna, Purna Meva Avashishyate, it always remains Purna. Now, it is this innate instinct in us for completeness that makes us work hard in life to become complete. Inside it is there somewhere and we think we will find it outwardly. So we try to make it complete. We never succeed. Yeah, a little bit is there, then that is not there. I have wealth, I don't have a child. I have child, I don't have wealth. It's never complete. So to become complete is our natural instinct, because in our true essence it is completeness. But we think we will bring about that completeness in outer life, which will never work. I mean, it doesn't work until we rest in peace, finally. So, but why do we seek to become complete? Because deep down, instinctually, we are complete. We are seeking that completeness, like the Kasturi Mruga. We are seeking it outside because it is instinctually in us to seek it. But we turn direction in. Direction is different. So that is Purna, that is Shunya, that is Brahman, that is yourself. So you are such a glorified being. Why do you think you are only this little fellow? And all infinite energies are in you to be tapped. But we hypnotize ourselves to think that we are small, my territory is only this much. So Swami Vivekananda put it nicely, he says, we are all hypnotized, find a way to dehypnotize yourself. And he also gave a beautiful story of how a small lion cub got left over with the goats, and brought up by the goats. And it lived like a goat. And then when one lion attacked, it started bleating and running, and the lion stopped him and said, "Hey, you are one of us. Why are you doing this?"
Ego. Because, the awareness exists in the dunya and is pure awareness. But does the ego, is that part and parcel of the first three states?
Yeah. See, the first three states with which the mind builds up our personality, our whole life, we have a personality, right? It's all built up through these three states. However, that has a small inkling of Turiya, the state of Turiya. That is why it thinks so highly about itself. Not knowing that as long as you are only in these three states, that is not attainable. But it is that ego which is, when I say I am big, actually I am big, but not as me. So there is a trace of that in us which makes us think, and then it becomes a strong ego. So the what is the way out?
So there is a continuity of the ego.
Absolutely.
Definitely the waking state.
Yes.
But about the sleep and dream state.
Even then it is there, even though it's not active. In deep sleep, the ego is there, is dormant. But there it is reflecting the inner self in complete relaxed state. That's all. So therefore it is aware of it when it wakes up. If we can do it while we are awake, then it will be, then you are free. So one bird has escaped from the cage. Many birds are there. The cage, unfortunately the cage is so attractive and so much made of gold and jewels and all, it's difficult to fly out. When it comes out, you know how it flies. What is that flying thing which Kabir talks about? Urjai. Akela Urjai. Now that Akela is such a beautiful word. Aloneness. In fact, people have Kaivalya in yoga. In yoga philosophy, the, like moksha, they say Kaivalya. Now, Kaivalya actually derives from Kevalam, being alone, only oneself, nobody else. So, Kaivalya means Akela. There is nothing else but aloneness. In that aloneness, everything is included. Somebody said, alone is made up of all one. I mean, something like that, similar to that. So, you said some... About? Is meditation?
An act of observation.
Absolutely. There are different kinds of... When you say meditate, it simply means fixing your attention on something. Now, there are many ways you can fix your attention on an image or a thought or a sound or even an abstract idea. But what meditation turns into pure observing, pure awareness, then it is the same as moving the truth. Pure awareness, there is nothing else. I am trying to be aware of myself in my true essence, not about something external. But there is no interference of me and that and so on. There is only alone. I'm alone. That awareness in its deepest sense is called meditation. It's like... every year, J. Krishnamurti used to come for talks in Vasant Vihar, Chennai. So one day, for some reason, somebody told him, today's subject of the thought is, of the talk is going to be meditation. He was completely worried. I saw him in the evening, he said, meditation, but I don't know anything. I said, what, sir? What do you mean you don't know? In Vasant Vihar, he said, they said, meditation. Do you think anybody is going to believe me? I said, sir, it's okay. So he went. He was like a child sometimes. So he went and sat there and all, and then he clipped this thing and he said, "Today we have been asked to speak of meditation. So let me explain what is not meditation." So everybody was looking up and down. So now this is like Adi Shankara saying, "Not this, not this, not this, neiti, neiti, neiti." Some people don't like it. Neiti, neiti. Not this, not. So he went about that, not this, with a sledgehammer. Not in a soft way, like a sledgehammer. Whatever we had, our favorite ideas of meditation were all broken. You know, thrown. Somebody said japa. So everything was over. There is nothing more to catch yourself and say this is meditation. There is nothing to hold on to. And then he said, kept quiet, and it was beautiful. Actually, it was very meditative. Sun was setting and there was a crow flying across. I can distinctly remember it. And it was such a beautiful meditation. Because all meditation has been broken down. Clinically, like a surgeon with a knife. And there was nothing left except, and then it was spoiled by one guy who stood up in the front and suddenly said, "Sir, then what is meditation?" And the reaction was very funny. He put both his head in both hands like this and he said, "Oh God, what a generation." That awareness, when everything is over, not over physically, but while we are still in the waking state. Thank you. You had a wonderful time. Thank you very much.